HarperCollins presents The Intruders by Louise Jensen. Read by Helen Keeley. Dedication. For Sarah Wade, with much love. Now. I didn't mean to hurt anyone. But it's irreplaceable. And after it was taken, I was desperate to get it back. Now that I have it again, I'll do anything to keep it. Anything. After you've heard my story, I think you'll understand. I think, perhaps, you'd do the same. Prologue. 30 years ago. Somebody's trying to break into the house. It's almost inaudible. The sound of the front door handle being lowered. Slowly. Slowly. But on her way back from the fridge with a bottle of wine, Marina hears the squeak, sees the movement. Her heart pounds painfully in her chest. Think. Her husband is upstairs, taking a shower. All of her family are upstairs, their youngest child already in bed, the eldest supposedly reading. Marina's eyes are locked on the handle. But it doesn't move again. Had she imagined it? There's a raging storm battering the house. Could the ferocious wind have rattled the door? She checks that it is locked. The grandfather clock shows it's only just gone 8:15, but the nights are already lengthening. From the record player in the drawing room, Flanagan and Alan sing Run, Rabbit, Run. She's playing the song not because she likes it, but to remind herself. Run, run, run. She shivers. It's cold in this part of the house. She thinks of the fire she has lit as she peers out of the window. Outside, the sky is inky black, the moon casting a creamy light. In the darkness, the window is a mirror. All she can see is her own worried face peeking back at her. Rain lashes against the leaded pane, a cold breeze pushing through the cracks in the frames. The beech tree creaks and bends. A branch tap, tap, taps against the glass. Let me in. Let me in. Let me in. She is just berating her overactive imagination, allowing herself to relax, heading back to the battered leather armchair that molds around her body, when she hears the crunch of gravel from the courtyard. A throaty cough. Oh God. This is not solely a storm, or a tree, or anything innocuous. Somebody is out there. There's a sudden whip of lightning. Startled by the flash, she whimpers, her fingers tightening around the neck of the wine bottle. The source of her nightly pleasure has now become a weapon. Thunder rumbles, low and loud. Remembering the back door, she hurries through the kitchen to double-check it's locked, feet cold against the flagstone floor. She grinds to a halt, horrified. A face outside the kitchen window, eyes staring in, hot breath misting the glass. She presses herself against the wall, trying to make herself invisible. The lingering scent of mince and onions from the children's dinner turns her stomach. The shadow lifts, the figure gone. Hurry. Marina rushes back to the entrance hall, picks up the phone with a shaking hand. Her fingers are trembling so violently she has to jab at the number several times until she gets it right. 999. As soon as she is connected, she whispers urgently, stating her name, that she lives in Newington House, that she is scared. Somebody is trying to break in. She garbles that she is downstairs by the front door. That no, she is not safe. When she had first moved here, she had loved the solitude. There aren't any neighbors for miles. It's so beautiful when the buttery sun melts over the woodland. Peaceful. Often the only sound is the rustling of leaves, the birds singing loud and clear, the bubbling of the brook. Now she feels too isolated. Aside from her family, there's nobody to hear her scream.
Mrs. Madley, help is on the way, the operator says in a calm voice. Who else is in the house with you?
My family. She runs through them, even though it is painful to think of her youngest child, starfished in the cot bed that has been passed down through generations, in the pale yellow nursery where cheerful ducks march endlessly around the border. The eldest child, a teenager, concentrating on her book, forehead creased as she absorbs herself in a world which, right now, is very preferable to this one. Why, oh why, couldn't she be out with some unsuitable boy tonight? Her husband, shampooing his hair, apple-scented suds frothing down the drain.
How long will the police take to get here? Marina asks.
What should she do in the meantime? There are precious things under this roof that she needs to protect.
The shatter of glass from the kitchen. A creak. The back door opening. The phone thuds from her hand. Dizziness engulfs her. Ridiculously, she is still clutching the bottle of wine. Her mouth hanging open as she draws in shallow breaths, sweat trickling from her upper lip into her mouth. Think. She hears the sound of a low voice muttering. The dull thud of footsteps. Slow. Leaden. Somebody is inside the house. Terror beats at her chest with clenched fists. Run. She darts into the great hall, eyes wildly seeking refuge. The oak paneling Marina had once thought so elegant, now dark and oppressive, closing in on her. The beamed ceiling pressing down. She could try and find somewhere to hide, but upstairs, she has to warn her family. Has to. She raises the bottle. Can she really smash it into somebody's face? Yes. Yes, she can do whatever it takes. Her fight or flight response has kicked in, and she is not running away. But she has never, ever felt so scared. From upstairs, the groan of a floorboard. One of the children moving around their room. Don't come downstairs. Don't come downstairs. Don't come downstairs. She sprints, her socked feet slip sliding. Has almost made it to the bottom of the stairs in the corner of the room, when an arm snakes around her neck, a hand clamps across her mouth. The wine bottle smashes as it hits the floor, liquid splattering her legs. She writhes and kicks and tries to bite the fingers that smell of nicotine. And that's when she notices. There is somebody approaching her. Two. There are two people in her house. Possibly more. Hysteria rises. The intruder is wearing a mask, a sheep's head, and she has never seen anything more terrifying. Tears leak from her eyes as she watches helplessly as he takes the stairs two at a time. She's still fighting to be free. Her family? Marina is bundled roughly away from the stairs into the drawing room. Shards of glass from the broken bottle pierce the tender skin on the soles of her feet, leaving a trail of bloodied footprints behind her. She tries to resist, knocking over a side table with her elbow as she scrabbles for traction on the oak floors. A china bowl smashes on the ground, the scent of floral potpourri cloying. It had always been her favorite, but after tonight she would forever associate the smell with this. If there is an after. She feels a momentary rise of hope that her husband might have heard the bowl smash, but this is dashed when she hears the water gurgling in the ancient pipes. He's still in the shower. She imagines him naked, vulnerable, unable to protect them. She wants to weep. The intruder throws her onto the green velvet sofa. She scurries into the corner and folds in on herself, crossing her arms over her chest, both forming a barrier and trying to hold herself together. Help! She screams.
There's the stinging crack of a hand across her cheek. She begins to cry.
Please don't hurt me. I can give you money.
Money is not what I'm here for. The voice is sharp from behind the mask. Terror is a heavy pressure building in her lungs.
Breathe.
She can't.
Think. Please, take what you want. Those candle holders are solid silver. You could sell them. I've got jewelry upstairs.
This is not a robbery.
But there are antiques. You could...
I am not here for money.
What do these people want?
But when she learns what it is, she shakes her head, shocked, confused. The intruder advances towards her, eyes blank behind the sheep mask. She cowers, her cheeks still throbbing with pain, fearing there is more to come. Marina is shaking so violently, her teeth rattle together. I called the police. They're on their way. If you leave now, you can get away. I won't tell them anything. I haven't seen your face.
Almost in slow motion, bathed in the orangey glow from the crackling fire, the intruder slowly lifts off the mask and grins. And that's when Marina knows with certainty. She is going to die tonight. There is a chilling scream from somewhere above her. Her eldest.
No, she's just a child, a teenager!
What is the man upstairs doing to her? She staggers to her feet, charges towards the door, feet stinging, feels a burning pain in her skull. Instantly, there are fingers wrapped around her hair. She feels a clump being yanked from her scalp.
Please,
she begs, her arms above her head, hands holding the intruder's wrists, digging her nails sharply into skin, clawing at it.
Bitch!
She is roughly pushed away, landing heavily onto her hands and knees. A foot stamps on her back so she's sprawled flat on the floor, clutching the edges of the rug. Rockets of pain shoot through her spine.
Please,
she begins to crawl, begging not just for her life, but for her family's. Reverberating through the house, her husband's roars of pain.
Please!
Somehow she staggers to her feet, hands held out in front of her.
Please, stop!
Every cell in her body buzzing with panic, willing for someone to save her, for the sound of sirens, for anything. Lightning whips, thunder grumbles.
Mummy?
The sound of a small voice.
I'm scared.
The intruder releases her, stalks towards her youngest child, her baby, freshly bathed in hedgehog pajamas. Innocent.
No!
She leaps onto the intruder's back.
No!
The breath leaves her body in one violent rush as she's tossed onto the floor as though she weighs nothing. As though she is nothing. Fueled by a primal instinct, she scrambles to her feet, propels herself forward again. She doesn't see the knife, doesn't feel it pierce her body. She crumples, hands automatically seeking out the wound, feeling the warmth of the blood flow through her splayed fingers, smells the metallic tang. She stares in horror as the intruder grabs for her child. She wills herself to move, but she can't. She cannot give what has been demanded, but she cannot bear what she is seeing, what she is hearing.
Please,
she begs, no longer sure what she is begging for. Now, finally, she hears the sirens, through the glass, the flash of blue lights. It has felt like hours, but can only have been minutes. The record player whirs and clicks as it restarts the record. Run, run, run. She closes her eyes.
Part 1. Chapter 1. Cass. Now. 30 years later. The blindfold is tight, the knot against the back of my head uncomfortable. I've never felt so small, so vulnerable. My anxiety is through the roof as I lick my dry lips and wait. And wait. Finally, the opening of the car door, a hand on my elbow. I unfold myself from the passenger seat, stumble on my pins and needles feet.
I've got you.
James steadies me.
We're not going far. You won't need your coat.
My heart rate begins to slow, as cool air caresses my cheeks. The outside bringing a sense of space that chases away the feeling of being trapped. That all too familiar feeling that causes panic to rise in my throat. Can I take this off now? My fingers flutter to one of James's work ties binding my eyes.
Not yet. I want it to be a surprise.
The excitement in James's voice is palpable. I don't ruin things by telling him that anywhere we are right now is likely to be a surprise. Unlike him, I didn't grow up in the South. Almost everywhere is unfamiliar. Stripped of my sight, my other senses are heightened. I use them to search for clues. I can't hear any traffic, so we must be somewhere remote. Although, from what I've seen of the area where James grew up, everywhere is remote. It's impossible to reach anywhere without driving past acres of green fields first. The birdsong is loud, and there's the rustle of leaves, so we must be surrounded by trees. I inhale. The early morning rain has intensified the smell of grass. I can taste the freshness on my tongue. There's no pollution here. The ground underfoot crunches before hardening, gravel and concrete. It isn't so much where we are that I'm desperate to know, but why we're here. Why the secrecy? Images of an ice bucket propping up a bottle of champagne, a board of pungent cheeses and a punnet of strawberries come to me. A red tartan picnic blanket. James on one knee, a glittering ring. But surely not today. Autumn nipping at the tip of my nose, my cheeks. It's too cold. Too soon? Although I've never been as certain about anything as I am about James. We've only been together 6 months. It's both no time at all and a lifetime. I can't imagine being with anyone else. Despite what my father.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.